Okay, so let's continue from where we left off yesterday. We were discussing about the data flow graph as a way of representing signal processing algorithms, and we were essentially trying to understand what it means to talk about the concept of an iteration of a data flow graph. And the goal that we are sort of heading towards is essentially we want to be able to understand what does it mean to define something called the iteration period, what is the minimum possible iteration period that can be usefully used on a graph, and how does that help us in turn with actually implementing the data flow graph on some kind of hardware. Okay, so the example that we were working with yesterday was an IIR filter with the equation y of n equals a times y of n minus 1 plus x of n. What we saw was that the data flow graph, one possible representation of the data flow graph for this could look something like this. There is a source that emits x samples. There is an adder. The output of the adder is essentially the y of n. One sample delayed version of that adder goes through a multiplier with the coefficient a and comes back in here to the adder. Okay, so structurally you can see that it looks slightly different from what I drew yesterday, but that's just a question of how I've rearranged the nodes in the graph. So obviously that doesn't make any difference. But more importantly, keep in mind that the data flow graph representation itself may not be unique, right? Depending on who is drawing it and what you consider as the main computational components in your system, you could end up with slightly different looking versions of the graph, although more or less you expect it to look more, substantially similar, right? So for example, there might be some other version of this graph where I might not explicitly draw the source node at all. I might not consider that as a separate unit. Okay? So those are sort of minor changes that we will ignore. And what we are going to assume is that for the most part, if you are given an equation, then it's possible to come up with a data flow graph representation of that corresponding equation. Okay, we also talked about the notion of actors. Essentially, each of these nodes over here is an actor, and the notion of firing of these actors, right? What we mean by firing is one execution of each of the functional nodes, right? And what we said is based on this, we can come up with a so-called trace. An example trace would look like this. S0, okay, I need to relabel these. I call this A for adder and M for multiplier. So that one possible trace through this is basically S0, M0, A0, S1, M1, A1, S2, M2, A2, etc. Right? Keep in mind that this is only one possibility. As we saw, there are many different possibilities that can come up over here. What we would like to understand is, are there any fundamental properties, any limitations on the kind of different traces that we have? And in turn, can we get some useful information from understanding those traces? Okay? Now, again, the way that I have written the trace over here makes it explicit that first S0 happens, then M0, then A0, then S1, M1, A1, etc. Right? That is how it would look, for example, if you were writing a C code to implement this entire system, right? Because C is fundamentally a sequential programming language. C, assembly, Java, any of those are fundamentally at their core sequential programming languages. The assumption is that when you write a function, each step in the function is executed one after the other in that correct sequence in which it has been represented, and the final output is then obtained after all the steps have been executed. Okay. That's not really necessary. I mean, the data flow graph by itself is not imposing such a restriction. So what we'll see next is it possible to sort of get around that? Can you sort of change the way in which those are executed? And how can we figure out that what are the true dependencies, that is something that has to happen after something else, versus just something which happened because of the way that I wrote the trace. Okay? Now I'm going to make a further assumption that each of these nodes has a certain execution time associated with it. And I'll call them respectively TS, TA, and TM. So it's obvious to you which refers to which, right? TS is the time for execution of the source. That can be thought of as maybe the time required for the source. Maybe it's an A to D converter. How much time does it take to convert one sample and provide it to you? Or if you're reading from a disk, it might be the time required for reading one sample of data from the disk and providing it, the average time perhaps, okay? TA is the time required to perform one addition, and TM is the time required for one multiplication, okay? For now, assume that all are equal to 1, right? That's just so that my drawing becomes a little bit easier. It has no real impact on the analysis that we will be going through later, okay? Right, so with this in mind, let's now look at, can we define something called the iteration period and find out how much time it takes on average to perform one iteration of this graph? And from there, can we go further and find out, are there any fundamental limits on this iteration period? Okay, so with the numbers that I have put down over here, what's the iteration period for this trace that I have written? Three, right? Why? Because essentially what I can look at is, this is one iteration, right? S0, M0, A0. Once I have finished all three of them, essentially it means that all three actors in the graph have executed once. That is the completion of one iteration. Okay, so this I will call as iteration 0, okay, because they correspond to S0, M0, A0. This one I will call as iteration 1. This is iteration 2, etc. Right? So the iteration period is equal to 3 for the above trace. Okay? Now let's look at a slightly different trace for the same graph. Okay? What I'm going to say is S0, S1, M0, A0, M1, A1, S2, S3, M2, A2, M3, A3. Right? This is also a valid trace, right? Now I'm just putting dots at the end. Either you can assume that it's going to be a periodic repetition of the pattern that we have seen so far, or something else. I don't really care. All that I care about is what I can see so far and what can I sort of deduce from the trace that I'm able to see up to this point. If it is a periodic pattern or beyond that, then yes, I can extrapolate from what I am seeing over here. But otherwise, I can only calculate whatever I can see from the trace. Okay? Now, is this a valid trace? That's the first question. And the reason I have said it is a valid trace is because none of the dependencies have been violated. Right? We already saw from this yesterday that S can execute as many times as possible as it wants to, right at the beginning, because it does not have any dependencies. It's like an A to D converter. As long as the input data is present, it will keep on generating outputs. It's not waiting for anything else. Okay? If the next stage can't store the data or can't take the data and do something with it, that's not the ADC's problem. Okay? It will just generate data as and when it is ready. But the adder and the multiplier have cross connections. Okay, so there is a bit more of a restriction in terms of what we can do over there, which is why after M0, I can't really have M1, right? Because M1 depends on the output of A0, and A0 of course depends on the output of M0. Therefore, this sequence M0, A0, M1, A1 is fine. But after M1, A1, I can't go to M2, because, or rather I can go to M2 if necessary, right? But I can't go to A2, for example, until S2 has happened, which is why I have written this particular sequence, S2, S3, and so on. Okay? So now that we are convinced that this is a valid trace, let's sort of see how do we define iteration period over here. Okay? First of all, what is iteration 0? Okay? What would you consider as iteration 0? All the operations in iteration 0 have to get completed, which basically means that up to this point. Right? These three are completed, at that point iteration 0 has completed. What about iteration 1? It basically corresponds to S1, M1 and A1. Okay, iteration 2 corresponds to these three, iteration 3 to these three, etc. Okay, so a couple of observations here. One is iterations can overlap. Before the 0th iteration has completed, the 2nd iteration has started. Okay? Is it possible for the 2nd iteration to complete before the 0th iteration? That does not really make sense, because by definition, the first execution of M or A or whatever it is considered as part of the 0th iteration. Right? So all the executions, the first round of executions will all be associated with the 0th iteration. The second round of executions will be associated with the first iteration, and so on. Okay, so it doesn't seem possible for iteration 1 to finish before iteration 0, but it can start before iteration 0 has finished. That much is clear. Okay, the second thing is, what is the iteration period that we have over here? That's a slightly more tricky question, right? Because we have two factors operating at hand, operating over here, right? One is the fact that how much time did it take for iteration 0 to complete? It took 4 time steps. It started at time 0, and went on up to time 3. Right? Went on from 0 to 3, so 4 time units. Iteration 1 goes on from 1 to 5, right, which is 5 time units. Iteration 2 goes from 6 to 9, 4 time units. Iteration 3 goes from 7 to 11, 5 time units, and so on. Okay, but what is this? Is this really the periodicity, or is it just the time required for finishing that iteration? It's the time required for finishing that particular iteration, right? So this number that we are seeing over here is not really the iteration period, because iteration period is sort of a property of the long-term trace. How, on average, how quickly are iterations getting completed? That word "on average" is, the phrase "on average" is a bit tricky. That's strictly speaking not the exact definition of iteration period, but for the time being, just for ease of understanding, I'm going to use that. Okay? So in any case, one thing that you can see over here is the time required for one iteration to complete, first of all, can vary between 4 and 5 over here, right? But that's not really indicative of the periodicity either, of how, at what rate we are finishing iterations. Okay? This number, this time required for finishing a particular operation, this is referred to as the latency. Okay? The latency essentially means, what is the time required for from the start to finish of a particular iteration? Okay, You can think of it as from the time that I give the inputs, how much time does it take until the last output is received? Okay, so the latency in this case could be 4 or 5 time units. The worst case latency is 5 time units over here. Okay, at least for whatever I have shown so far, assuming that the same pattern continues periodically, it remains that way. You know, the minimum latency is 4 time units, the maximum latency is 5 time units. So that's okay, right? What about the iteration period? How do we find that out? Right? Another word for the iteration period, in fact, in this case, is something that we will call, I mean, again, so there are two things at work over here. One is what is the average iteration period? The other is something else called the initiation interval or the iteration interval. Okay, so average iteration period is sort of easy to understand over here. Time required for finishing n iterations divided by n. Okay, so in this case, let's take time for 4 iterations divided by 4 is equal to how much? I am able to finish 4 iterations starting from time 0 and finishing at time 11. Therefore, 12 time units. Okay? So 12 time units divided by 4, and this comes out to be 3. Okay? So even though any given iteration is taking more than 3 time units, okay, I am intentionally using the word time units to sort of keep it neutral. If you find that difficult, then just think of it as clock cycles, right? And you can basically think of each of my operational units, the S, A and M, as maybe taking one clock cycle to perform their work. So every tick of the clock, they do something, right? But the reason I'm just saying time units over here is because it need not be clock cycles. It could be even some kind of an asynchronous system where each one has its own free running clock internally and, you know, takes a certain amount of time, or each of those could even be a combinational system where the time unit is actually nanoseconds, right? The same analysis holds in all cases. Okay, so average iteration period works out to be 3 time units, even though the latency can be higher than that. Okay, the next question essentially comes out to be the initiation interval, okay, or the iteration interval. What do I mean by this? I am essentially asking the question, after iteration 0 starts, what is the time before iteration 1 can start? Okay, so from I0 to I1, what is the time? 1 clock second, 1 time unit, right? But what about I1 to I2? I1 started at 1, I2 starts at 6, okay? So this is 5 time units, right? So what we see over here is an interesting thing. One is the iteration interval, the initiation interval, right? It had a minimum value of 1, that is, I started I0 on 1 clock cycle, and in the very next clock cycle I started I2, or rather, sorry, I started I0 and then I started I1, okay, on the next clock cycle. Therefore, within 1 clock cycle time difference, I am able to start my next iteration, not complete it, but start it. Okay, that's my initiation interval. But was I able to again start on the very next clock cycle after that? No. Once again, I had the problem that I then had to wait until I0 and I1 completed before I2 could start. Okay, so I2 essentially goes to 5 time units later. Okay, so in all of this, what we are ultimately trying to find out is, are there any fundamental limits? Okay, so all of this was based on just traces that we took through the data flow graph. right? Now we are going to try and relax one assumption, which is that everything is going to happen in a sequential trace, and we'll see how the structure of the traces changes and what impact it has on the latency and the iteration period. Okay, so these values, the latency and the initiation interval, right, in particular, are very important parameters that we'll have to keep in mind later as we go for actual synthesis of circuits. Okay, the reason why the initiation interval can sometimes be more important than the latency is because of something called pipelining, which basically allows us to have multiple things running at the same time. Even if each individual computation is taking a long time to finish, I am still able to get a high throughput, because after some huge initial latency, I start getting outputs very quickly. Okay, the sort of more detailed analysis of that, and you know, understanding that a bit better, we'll see with some examples later on. But these two values, the latency and the initiation interval, are important, and we'll need to sort of have a clear picture of what they mean and how they are, how we need to understand them as we move forward. Okay, so now let's look at going away from a single trace, right? And what happens if I allow multiple things to execute in parallel? Okay, we'll just talk about parallel execution for now. So what I'm going to assume is, just for ease of understanding, I'm going to redraw that graph over here. What I have is S, A, M with a D on it, and this feedback. Okay? At t equal to 0, what are all the things that are ready to execute? What are the actors that I could fire if necessary? S, so I'll write on S0 over here. What else? S1 is also possible, right? But I'm going to leave aside that for the time being. So in principle, yes. If I had infinite number of processors, I could have also written, you know, S1, S2. All of them are in principle capable of executing right at the start. Okay, but I don't really gain anything by that, so I'm going to leave that out of the picture, right? And in fact, what we'll see later is any of these things that are just sort of feeding into the input and don't have any feeding into the main loop of the system and don't have any other dependencies on their input are not really sort of are not going to be the determining factors in terms of our final implementation. So I'll leave that out for the time being and just assume that, yeah, S0 can execute. If necessary, I know that S1, S2, etc. can execute, but I'm not going to bother with them. Let's look at the other nodes. What else can execute? M0. Okay? So rather than putting M0 at time 1, I'll say, okay, why not execute that also at time 0 itself? Because after all, it's ready. Okay? Now comes the question, what about at time 1? Okay, is S1 ready to execute? Yes, of course, it was already ready at time 0, it could execute now as well. Nothing really preventing me from doing that, so I'll just go ahead and put down S1 over here. What about A0? A0 is now ready because it has a token sitting on its input, which it can absorb and execute. Okay, so A0 could execute over here after M0. Just for clarity, maybe let me just put this down on a separate thing. It need not be on the same piece of hardware, right? So it could be on a separate processor. I don't care. Right? But the important thing to keep in mind is M1 cannot execute. Right? At time 1, M0 already finished at time 0. At time 1, M1 is not ready because it's still waiting for input from the adder. okay, when is M1 ready to execute? Only after that, at time 2. Okay, so at time 2 I could have S2 over here, which of course could have been finished earlier as well, so I don't really care, but the important point is M1 can now execute over here. Okay, what about at time 3? I can therefore have A1, then I can have M2, A2 and so on. Okay, now let's look at the same set of values that we were looking at earlier. What's the latency of an iteration? 2 clock cycles, because it takes M0, A0 two time units to finish both of those together, right? What's the iteration period? Average iteration period, you can look at it as what's the time required for finishing, in this case, 1 or 2 or 4, whatever, it doesn't matter, because they all take the same amount of time. It's basically 2 time units again. Okay. And in this case, the initiation interval also turns out to be exactly the same. Right? Because after M0, M1 starts 2 clock cycles later or 2 time units later. Okay. So now this is interesting. Essentially what I have said is, now I no longer have the restriction that things have to execute on the same piece of hardware, and therefore I'm not talking about sort of linear traces anymore, right? I have some processors, some pool of processors that I have over here, right? As many as I need, and I'm trying to execute the steps on that. Okay. And I find that in this particular case, at least one valid set of, one valid trace, one possible way of executing this is to do it with latency equal to 2, iteration period equal to 2, initiation interval equal to 2. Okay. The question that arises at this point is this 2 something fundamental? Can I do anything better than 2, especially in terms of the iteration period? Can I get my iteration period below 2? Okay, can I bring it down below 2 in this case? Yeah.
So this iteration interval is defined as starting of the next iteration.
The time between the start of iteration I and iteration I plus 1. Actually, that's a good point. So you're right. So, okay. In fact, that's a good observation. I've, in this case, happily gone ahead and written S1, S2, etc. over here. But what happens after a while, right? Actually, if I start doing S3, S4 and so on, after a while, I find that this is going to, you know, where is the M3, M4 going to happen? Much later, right? So if I continue with this, I have a possibility of filling up a buffer, right? That's one way of looking at it. I'm generating too much data, more than I can absorb. Okay? This could fill up the buffer. What do I mean by a buffer? I'll just put it within quotes for now, because this is something that we will need to understand in more detail later. Essentially, what I'm saying is I can think of this link over here between S and A as having some capability of storing samples. Right? If it's an A to D converter, typically that will be one register. Right? But if it is something else, it's something that's operating inside the memory of a processor, it could actually be some amount of memory storage that is allocated for storing the samples so that they can be pulled out later. The point is, if S just keeps on executing as quickly as possible, S0, S1, S2, S3 on every clock cycle, after a while, I find that the M0, A0, M1, A1, M2, A2, M3, A3, that sequence is happening slower. It's not able to absorb the data quick enough. Okay? And automatically, if I don't want to lose data, I will have to slow down my S0, S1, that part of it. Okay? And if I look at it, the S can essentially, you know, it has complete freedom. It can either execute or not execute. It doesn't make any difference to the final operation. It's not going to slow things down as long as there is always data present. Okay, so if I leave a gap somewhere and I say that, you know, I'm just going to skip in time step 3, I won't execute S3. I'll switch it over to time 4 instead, right? It does not affect my functionality. Okay, so based on that, we can actually say that once I have gone on for long enough, I will fall into a regular periodic pattern. I can expect that I'll fall into a regular periodic pattern where the S will be produced as and when it is required. Okay, but yes, that is an important point. I mean, you know, it, in principle, I am not really demarcating iterations exactly over here, right? And if you think more closely about it, it sort of tells you that, look, that S, which was only feeding data in from somewhere else, is not really the constraining factor as far as determining your iteration period or the initiation interval. Okay, the other two actors, M and A, are the ones that are finally going to set your limit. Okay, so please think of it that way. I mean, you need to sort of think about this a little bit and make sure you have a clear picture of what's going on. Iterations may not always be clearly defined and periodic, right? You can always define an iteration just in terms of have all the actors associated with one iteration completed, right? But is it just going to be a completely periodic pattern always? That is not necessary. We already saw that over here, right? The previous one sort of showed you that, you know, there are already two different patterns at work, right? And in general, it's possible to even be completely aperiodic. A trace could be completely aperiodic as well. I could intentionally sort of skip things here and there and make push things around so that it remains always non-periodic, right? But the point is, when I'm trying to minimize the time required for the latency, iteration period and so on, right? And I, at the same time, I also don't want to end up in a situation where too much data sort of accumulates in one place. Automatically, I will fall into a regular periodic pattern after a while. Okay? So, anyway, the question that we want to sort of answer over here is, this value of 2 time units or 2 cycles that I'm seeing over here, is it something fundamental? Is there any way that I can reduce my iteration period even below this value, or am I, you know, fundamentally sort of limited by what the by some property of this data flow graph itself? That's what we would like to understand. Okay, so to understand this with one more example, what we'll do is the thing that we left out yesterday, which is the FIR filter. We didn't look at what the data flow graph for an FIR filter looks like, right? And the equation that we had over there was AX of n plus BX of n minus 1 plus CX of n minus 2. Okay, and what I'm saying is that the data flow graph for this, essentially I'll have an S, multiply by A. I'll just call this M1, right? Notation can get confusing now because I'm using M subscript 1 to indicate the first multiplier. I will also then be giving M1 0 in order to indicate the 0th iteration of the first multiplier and so on. It should be fairly clear from the context what we are talking about. Okay, if it's not, then let me know. Now, A is used to multiply X of N. A delayed version of X of N is multiplied by B, and a 2 delayed version of X is multiplied by C. Okay. Now, if you look at this, it's a bit interesting. All the previous diagrams that we had, the block diagram, signal flow graph, and so on, first generated a single delay, and from there generated the 2 delayed version, right? Whereas for the data flow graph, I'm saying, look, I don't really care how you generate a 2 delayed version. Are you going to generate it by actually delaying one element twice? Or is it just a 2 delayed version that is available from somewhere? Maybe it's already sitting somewhere in the memory of a system. Okay, which is why I'm separating out how the delay is generated from how much delay is required. Okay, the fact that the delay might be generated by first putting it through a single delay and then putting it through another delay is not important. What is important is C multiplies x of n minus 2. If x of n minus 2 is already sitting somewhere in my memory and has been generated through some other means, so be it. That's all that I care about. Okay. Now, what do I need to do with all of these things? I need to add them. And once again, the way that I am drawing the data flow graph, other cases might draw it differently, is to assume that there is some kind of a magical 3-input adder, right? That's capable of doing all the 3 additions at one shot. You could break this up and make it into 2 adders, chain them in some way, right? It doesn't really make any difference to the data flow graph at the end of the day, right? Okay, so once again, if we look at possible traces for how this could execute, it might look something like this: S0, M10, M20, M30, A0, S1, M11, M21, M31, A1, and so on. Okay, so this is a so-called linear single processor trace, so to say, right, where everything is just happening in sequence, right? And over here, once again, it's easy to understand. The latency over here is going to be 5 time units. The iteration period is again 5 time units, and the initiation interval is also 5 time units. Okay. Now let's take this and switch it over to a multiprocessor trace. That is when I have more hardware available to me. Okay. So I'm going to say S0 happens here. And now the interesting thing is it has generated some data. Okay. What else could have executed at the same time? What else can execute in parallel with S0? M2 and M3, because they all have, both have initial conditions already present. They have sufficient prior information, older values, x of n minus 1, x of n minus 2, etc. I have to assume certain initial conditions for the system to start. They are already present because those tokens are present on those edges. Therefore, they are already actually ready to execute. Okay. So I could have M20, M30 happening over here. Okay. M10 on the other hand can happen only after S0 has completed, and A0 happens after that. Okay. So the interesting thing over here is, was there anything preventing me from running, even though A0 happened only by time 2, I could potentially run S1 straight away over here, which means M21 can also run over here, right? M31 can run here, M11 over here, and A1 over here. Right. So in other words, you can see a pattern forming over here. Okay. Which essentially looks like some kind of a slightly complicated looking block, which is then repeating periodically. Okay, let's look at it. Let's just make sure we understand why M10 can't occur over here. Look at M1. What does it depend on? There is a dependency over here, right? From S to M1. Okay. which means that there is no token present on that S2M1 arc to start with. There are no initial conditions present over there. So until S0 has completed and produced one piece of data, M10 cannot execute. That's all that we are, that's, I mean, essentially all that I'm doing is interpreting the meaning of this graph. Okay? So the graph as drawn over here is just saying that until S0 has executed and produced some output, M10 is not ready to execute. That's all. Okay? What are the numbers that we have over here? Latency is 012. By time 2 it has completed, therefore it's basically 3 cycles, 3 time units. Okay? What's the iteration period? If I look at, let's say, 10 iterations, or rather, let's take these 3 iterations, right? By time 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, I have finished 3 iterations, right? So, in other words, in order to compute this, 1 iteration, 3. 2 iterations, finish by time 4. 3 iterations by time 5. Okay? And in general, n iterations, at what time will they finish? N plus 2. Okay? Which means basically that the average iteration period is going to n plus 2 by n, which is basically tending towards 1. So the average iteration period for sufficient number of samples is going to be 1. Okay? And this is actually a key thing as far as signal processing systems are concerned, because unlike other kinds of computations where, you know, the computation is just performed once, we get an answer and we are done with it, the whole idea of a signal processing system is that it is repeatedly working. Right? It is, one way of describing it is that it is a sort of semi-infinite process. Semi-infinite because it has some starting time. Right? Even that is because of practical matters. I need to switch on the system at some point in time, therefore I assume certain initial conditions and so on. But from there onwards, the assumption is that it is always running. In practice, the moment I switch off the power, etc., you know, the whole thing shuts down. But still, by then it could have finished like millions, billions, trillions, whatever number of samples. Right? If you look at what's happening inside your phone, right, the A to D converters that are working on the data over there are probably working at like 100, you know, or maybe even like sort of massive underestimate is like 10 mega samples per second or something like that. Right? That's 10 million samples per second. Okay? Within one day, that's something like 10 power 12 samples. Right? So if you have managed to keep your phone on for one day, it basically means that the A to D converter has processed that many samples. Okay? So because of that, the n values that we are looking at over here, it's sort of safe to assume that n tends to infinity, and you know, we are interested in limits. We are interested in sort of the average case as time goes into steady state. So all of these initial conditions and sort of, you know, the buffer moving around, increasing in size and so on, we don't worry too much about it because primarily we are interested in steady state operation for sufficiently large number of samples. Okay? And this is what happens in this case. The iteration period comes out, it tends to 1. What about the initiation interval? That is much more clear actually in this case. Iteration 0 starts at time 0, iteration 1 starts at time 1. Okay, so it's very clear that in this case it's equal to 1. Okay, so the initiation interval, in other words, with this architecture, with what I have got over here, it's possible to start the iterations one after the other immediately. Okay, but we can take this one step further. Is this really the best that can be done for this particular data flow graph? Is it possible to reduce my iteration period even further? let's take another quick look at the data flow graph, right? What is it that we are ultimately concerned about? Making sure that no dependencies are violated, and under the condition that no dependencies are violated, I should be able to execute things in whatever order that I can. Okay? We already saw from the previous thing that S has no input dependencies, therefore it can execute as many times as it wants. If I had enough hardware, if I had some magical way by which, you know, I can generate multiple samples in the same clock cycle, then so be it. For an A to D converter, that probably does not make sense. But if I'm reading data that's already stored on a file, for example, it does make sense. I might be able to just read out multiple samples at the same time for processing. Okay? If that's the case, what can we do with this? I could consider another alternative where at time 0, I do S0 and S1. Okay? From this graph, only M20 can execute because that has one input sample on it. But M30 and M31 both can execute over here. Okay? And at time 1, what are the things that can execute? Because S0 and S1 are both ready, I could have M10 and M20, both of them, and the corresponding, you know, the M12. Well, M11 and M21, okay? And because I generated two samples the first time around, M22 can also execute now, right? Why am I saying that? Because essentially, when S executes twice, it puts two tokens on this S to M1 arc, two tokens on the S to M2 arc, two tokens on the S to M3 arc. Okay, that many samples are therefore ready to execute. M30, M31 have already gone ahead and executed, therefore M32 and M33 can execute at this point. Okay, and after this I can also say that the A values, right, so A0, A1 could both execute over here. Okay, I'm not going to draw this much more at this point because this is already enough to sort of show the basic idea of what I'm getting at, right? Which is the fact that because these two, S0, S1 could both execute together, these could execute together, then this and this etc., right? I basically end up with two samples processed per time unit. Okay, so n samples will finish in n by 2 plus 2 time units, which means the iteration period will basically become n by 2 plus 2 divided by 2, 1/2. This is the average iteration period for large enough values of n. Okay? Take this further. Why did I have to stop at 2? Could I have done 3? Could I have done 4? Could I have done 10? And the answer is yes. Okay? So as far as this particular data flow graph is concerned, the FIR filter that I've just shown over here, there was nothing really that prevented me in terms of the data dependencies. I'm not talking about hardware. I'm assuming that I have infinite amounts of hardware. Okay? I have some way by which all the data can be sort of read at one shot from a file maybe, or, you know, somehow magically provided to me at one shot. And that I have infinite amounts of hardware. the hardware itself might have a certain latency associated with it. That's okay, that will contribute to the overall latency of the computation, but the average iteration period can be brought as low as you want if you have enough computing resources. Okay, what we are going to do next, we'll stop here for now, but what we are going to do next is basically go back and look at the IIR filter. Can the same thing be done there? You probably can guess, no, it cannot. Okay, and that sort of tells you what is the fundamental limitation in terms of what can be done, what is the best possible throughput that can be achieved for iteration period for data flow graphs. Okay, and that in some ways helps us to sort of design systems, because now we have an idea of what is the best possible iteration period. We can automatically target, either if we want to get some throughput that is even better than that, then the only way of doing it is either change your algorithm or change the underlying hardware assumptions itself. That's the only way that we can get throughput beyond what the iteration period bound can allow. Okay, all right, we'll stop here for now. Tomorrow we will meet in the IE lab, the new IE lab. I'll basically be going over something related to the assignments and hopefully clear up the submission process so that we have a clear way of doing it from now onwards. Okay? All right.